From our archives, the Billy Graham Classics.
And now before the message, here's a song from George Beverly Shea.
I want to talk about Jesus Christ. I want to ask the question, who is Jesus? Many of us have crosses embossed on our Bibles or on our carrying around our neck, but we don't really know Jesus. You know, when you fly into Brazil, into Rio de Janeiro, there's a great big statue of Jesus. It's a landmark of Rio day and night. It stands 130 feet high. It's 130 feet from fingertip to fingertip with his arms outstretched. Someone has called this, in this country, the Year of Jesus. One of the networks recently ran a miniseries on Jesus. My daughter has written a book called Just Give Me Jesus. There's a movement among teenagers that asks the question, what would Jesus do? Almost everybody has heard of Jesus, but millions don't really know who he is. They don't have him in their lives and in their hearts. And the world today is looking for Messiah to come and save us. Many years ago, the prophet Ezekiel said, I searched for a man among them, but I found none. In other words, God was searching for someone that he could put his hand on and bless and use, and he couldn't find anybody that was willing to totally surrender and commit their lives to him. The world today, if you read the newspapers and watch the telecast, news telecast, is rushing madly toward, I think, Armageddon. Tonight in the Middle East, They're battling again over the same things they've battled for hundreds of years. They've had meeting after meeting and truce after truce and treaty after treaty and promises made by all around. But somehow they can't quit their fighting. You see, man is a moral failure. God is our only hope. God's plans. God's plans are already formed and are clearly stated in the scriptures. And at his right hand in heaven sits a man who was despised and ignored and rejected by men when he came to earth the first time, and who is still rejected and ignored by the majority of the human race. God has pledged that he will be the future world ruler. He will put down all rule and all authority and power. There's coming a day when every knee will bow to him and every tongue will confess his name. This year, 2000 AD, the calendar we use each day dates back to the birth of Jesus. We can't get away from him. Our generation cannot escape Jesus. Over the years, so many plays and books and operas and movies have been made about Jesus. In March and April, both Newsweek and U.S. News and World Report magazines had cover stories about him. In its Science and Ideas cover story, U.S. News carried the title, "Why Did Jesus Die?" Why is there so much interest in Jesus today? Is that the question you've asked? Who is this person who has done so much to transform human history than any man that ever lived? He only lived 33 years. His longest journey was less than 100 miles. Is he just a folk hero or a revolutionary? Or is he who he claimed to be? The Son of the Living God. Who is this person that demands we call him Son of God and follow him even to death? We know he was a man. He was completely human. He was the representative man. He was the all-out man. He was identified and numbered with the transgressors, the scripture says. 83 times in the New Testament, he's called the Son of Man. There are many places in the scriptures where we are reminded of his humanity. The Bible teaches that he was hungry. The Bible teaches that he was tired. In the back of a boat, he was asleep. He knew the joys of friendship. He was misunderstood and despised. He wept at the tomb of a loved one. He had to fight temptation and endure disappointment. He claimed to be the unique Son of God. Before the world ever was, or before the human race ever existed, he said, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And Jesus said, "Before Abraham was, I am." With these words, Jesus set himself aside from every other person that ever lived. In other words, Jesus said, "Before Abraham was born, I always am the eternal present." There's no past with Jesus and there's no future with Jesus. It's all in the ever present. And he's speaking to you tonight, and he's speaking to all of us collectively and individually. In Colossians 1, it says, "For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things. And by him all things hold together." This whole stadium would fly to pieces were it not for the fact that he is the thing that holds it together. Peter's statement in Matthew 16:16, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the Living God." When he came at Bethlehem, that was not his birth or his beginning. He had already existed. That was his incarnation. When Jesus came to Bethlehem, it wasn't the place of his origin. It was his incarnation. and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. You know, it's interesting to me that Jesus never apologized for sin. He challenged others to prove any error in his thinking or in anything that he ever did. How do we explain Jesus from every other individual that ever lived? How do we explain Jesus from every other person? What is the basic cause of hate and greed and lust and war today, and racial injustice and racial division? Jeremiah said, gave the answer. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? King David said, in sin did my mother conceive me. I was born in sin, said David. He said, I was shapen in iniquity. The Bible says in Matthew 15, for out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, and blasphemies. I think we need to do something about guns, but that's not the real problem. The real deep problem is in our hearts. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts and murders and adulteries and thefts and blasphemies. All of these things come from the heart of men and women. How do you explain Jesus? His authority. No one ever spoke as this man spoke, says John 7. He forgave sin. No other prophet had ever forgiven sin. Muhammad didn't attempt that. Buddha didn't do that. No one else in history has ever said your sins are forgiven. He also had authority over nature. When the sea was boiling and the storm was raging, he just held up his hand and said, peace be still, and the sea quieted down and the storm stopped. He had authority over disease. Every sick person that ever came to him by faith and he touched, he healed. But what about his death? Different than any other person that ever was. You see, Jesus was executed. He was a criminal. He took our sins. He became sin for us who knew no sin. Can you imagine a person being the embodiment of sin? That's what Jesus was on the cross. Isaiah 53 says, God hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. In 1 Peter 2:24, it says, who his own self bare our sins in his body on the tree. Micah says that all of our sins are cast into the depths of the sea. I was reading today about that lake in Russia. That's the deepest water in the whole world. Thousands of feet down. Our sins are buried in the depths of the sea, the scripture says, because of what Christ did on the cross. He became sin for us. He was executed for you. He took your judgment and your hell. You won't ever have to go to hell. You don't ever have to go before the great white throne judgment if you're in Christ. But everybody else will. The Bible says that there's coming a day when he's going to judge the whole world. And you will stand before God at the great judgment, hundreds of you that are here tonight. And you won't stand with a great crowd like this tonight. You say, oh, we'll have a good time when we get there. No, you'll be alone. You're going to stand before God alone and give an account of what you did with Jesus and how you lived your life. And many of us are going to be terribly disappointed. And we're going to scream for mercy. But it's going to be too late. The Bible says that we will call for the rocks and the mountains to fall on top of us and hide us from him that sits on the throne. But we can't. And the crucifixion of Christ is a stumbling block to many people because it's foolishness, the Bible says, to those that perish. Many will accept the teaching of Christ. When he says, love everybody, but they stop at the cross. At the cross is where you have to come before you can really know Him. And you have to confess that you're a sinner. And you have to repent from sin. And the word repentance means that you turn, that you change. You're going one direction in your life and you're willing to go another. You say, but Billy, I don't have that ability. I've tried to change. I've tried to do better. But I can't. No, you can't. But God will help you if you submit to Him and say, Lord, I need your help. I need your help even to repent. I need your help even to have faith to believe the kind of faith that I must have. What about you? And then there's His resurrection. The Bible says that they took Him out and they buried Him after His death. But on the third day, He rose again. And He's alive tonight. When some of the disciples went out to the tomb where He was buried, there were two men there, two angels, that said, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here, He's risen. Jesus is alive." And the thing which inspired the disciples to go to the whole world with the gospel is the resurrection. We're talking about a living Christ that can come into your life and heart today and change you, and change your family, and change your neighborhood, and change Nashville, and change Middle Tennessee, and change all of the whole country if we'll let Him. The Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, we shall be saved. You have to believe that He not only died, but that He rose again. That's one half of it. One half is that you repent. You come and say, "Oh Lord, I'm a sinner. I'm sorry that I've sinned. Please forgive me and help me to change." But then you have to live the life. And there the resurrected Christ is there through the Holy Spirit to help you live the life after you've come to Christ. If Christ is not risen, then He's not God. And the tremendous force in history is unexplained. The Apostle Paul, on the road to Damascus, was persecuting Christians and killing Christians. He hated Jesus. And one day, there was a blinding light, and he fell down on his knees, and he knew it was Jesus. And he said, "Who art thou, Lord?" In Acts, the 9th chapter. And this is the question you must answer. Who is Jesus? That's the question of our generation. Who is Jesus? Jesus claimed, if Jesus claimed to be God, knowing that He was not, He was a deceiver. If He thought that He was God and didn't know the difference, He was a maniac. Jesus was whom He claimed to be, God manifested in the flesh. Think of it, the mighty God that created those stars and those planets and this whole universe and holds it all together. He is the one that wants to come into your life, in your heart tonight, in a new way. Oh, you might be a member of the church. You might have been confirmed and baptized and all the rest. But deep down inside, you're just not sure. You're not certain that you're ready to meet God. You're not certain that you'll escape that great judgment. You must face the question that Pilate asked. What shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ? Pilate washed his hands. Tonight you can wash your hands and leave. And leave this stadium and go back to the old life and nothing has happened. But Paul was fearful. He was trembling. He was astonished. He was amazed. But he asked the right question. Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And Jesus said unto him, arise and go. And that's what Jesus is saying to you tonight, up in those stands and down here on this little stand. Arise and go. Get up out of your seat and make a new commitment to Jesus and make certain that your sins are forgiven. You see, this may be the only chance you'll ever have the rest of your life is tonight. You may not be able to come back to these meetings this week. You may never have another moment quite like this when the Holy Spirit has spoken to you as He's speaking tonight. And Jesus says in Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I'll come into him and fellowship with him. Jesus is knocking at your heart's door tonight. He wants to come into your heart. He wants to change your life. He wants to have an impact in your community and in your family and in your life. He wants to give you peace and joy that you've never known before. He wants to forgive all your sins, and He wants to give you assurance that if you died tonight, you'd go to heaven. You can have that assurance tonight before you leave here. And I'm going to ask you to do something that may be very difficult for you to do. But when Jesus died on that cross, He was dying for you because He loved you. And He's asking you to come in to open your heart to Him tonight. And if there's a doubt in your life about your relationship to Christ, you get up out of your seat right now and come and stand in front here on this beautiful stadium floor that they've put down. If you're with friends or relatives, they'll wait on you. And come and stand here, and I'm going to say a word to you and have a prayer with all of you and give you some literature to help you before you in your life in the week to come. You get up and come right now, men, women, young people, hundreds of you. Just get up and come and stand here. That's all. By that act, you're saying to God, I do open my heart to Jesus, who died for me and who rose again and who's alive tonight. And He's knocking at my heart's door. I can sense it. You get up and come. We're going to wait on you right now. If you've come with a group, they'll wait on you. If you've come in a bus, they'll wait. There's plenty of time. This is the most important moment in your life. Don't miss it. Quickly, from up in the top stands, you get up and come. It'll take you a little time. It'll take you 4 or 5 minutes, so come. We're going to be here to pray with you and to talk with you and to help you. While you're still coming, I want to say a word to all of you that will be watching by television. And you can make your commitment where you are. Wherever you are, you may be at home, you may be in a hotel room. I don't know where you are, but God is speaking to you. You make your commitment. Or you can call that number that you see on the screen. And there's somebody ready to talk to you right now and have a prayer with you. And we'll send you the same literature that we're going to give to people here tonight. You can make your commitment. You make it now.
you just prayed that prayer with my father, or if you have any questions about a relationship with Jesus Christ, I would just call that number that is on the screen. There'll be someone there to talk with you, pray with you, and answer those questions. And remember, God loves you.
If you would like to commit your life to Jesus Christ, please call us right now toll-free at 1-877-772-4559. That's 1-877-772-4559. Or you can write to us at Billy Graham, 1 Billy Graham Parkway, Department C, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28201. Or you can contact us on the web 24/7 at peacewithgod.tv. We'll get the same helps to you that we give to everyone who responds at the invitation. On behalf of Franklin Graham and the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, thank you for watching, and thank you for your prayers.
You're invited on a journey of discovery at the Billy Graham Library. Retrace Billy Graham's path from humble farm boy to international ambassador of God's love through multimedia, photos, and memorabilia.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love. That is a supernatural.
Tour the restored Graham family home place, browse Ruth's Attic Bookstore, and have a meal at the Graham Brothers Dairy Bar. Enjoy special exhibits, events, and seasonal activities for the whole family. Admission is free. So come walk this journey of discovery at the Billy Graham Library.
We are to wait for the coming of Christ with patience. We are to watch with anticipation. Scripture says Christ is coming when you're least expecting him. Coming as a thief. He said, be prepared. Get ready. Prepare to meet thy God. Are you prepared?
From our archives, the Billy Graham Classics.
Now tonight I want to talk on the subject of the home. How to save your marriage. How to have a happy home. Now many of these servicemen here haven't gotten married yet, but they come from homes and they're looking forward someday to having a home. So you can listen with interest as well, because every man and every woman is interested in the home and the problems involved in the home today. And our text is found in Matthew, the 19th chapter, beginning at verse 3, these words. The Pharisees also came unto him, tempting him, and saying unto him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause? And he answered and said unto them, have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? And said, for this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and the twain shall be one flesh. Wherefore they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. Is your marriage successful? Is your home happy? Is your home free from tension that possesses so many homes today? Or is your home turmoil and strife? Or is it a broken home? Or is it a home about to break up? One out of every four American marriages breaks up. But during the last 3 years, the statistics are shooting up again after leveling off for about 5 years. And now the big thing is wife swapping. And a magazine said the other day that several million couples in America practice wife swapping, searching for happiness. And because broken homes and divorce are now played up in so much of our mass media, that we assume that most homes are unhappy, but that's not true. I'm here to tell you tonight that the majority of the American homes stay together, and they are happy homes. We only read about the bad ones, the broken ones, the ones with turmoil and strife. Nearly all of our domestic problems faced by the nation begin in the home. We see on our screens the riots, the crime. Where does it begin? Most of our sociologists and criminologists tell us it begins in the home. Our nation can never rise higher than its home life. And on a radio network last week, they had a study of crime in America, and they said that the largest single contributor to murder is marital turbulence. Bitterness, crime, alienation, and even war begins in the home. Now, the first thing that God did after creation was to establish the home. He said, it's not good that man should be alone. I will make an associate to help him. And God created the woman to help man. Before the government, before the church, before any other institution, he established the home. And yet today, the home in our country is in danger. And the Bible says, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? The home is the very foundation of our society. Our men are fighting in Vietnam. Many of you men that are sitting before me tonight will go to Vietnam to fight. I've been in Vietnam. I've seen something of the war there. You may have to fight on other battlefields, on other continents. I don't know. But I know this, that we have a battle going on at home in America, and it's being fought in the home. And if the enemy wins the battle in our homes to break our homes, we're not going to have anything worth fighting for. We've got to reestablish the home as the basic unit of our society. And what are some of the elements in a successful and happy marriage? First, there must be a divinely ordered marriage. The Bible says if a house is divided against itself, that house or that home cannot stand. The Bible says, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now, this applies only to Christians. If you're a Christian, we are to marry another Christian. That's what that is saying. And in the Old Testament, God said to the people, oh, that there was such a heart in them that they would fear me and keep all my commandments always, that it might be well with them and with their children, and that they might have happy homes forever. The fear of the Lord and obedience to His plans and regulations for marriage almost guarantees a successful marriage, and it must begin in courtship. Start dating the right girl or the right fellow. Have prayer together. You say, Billy, don't be such a square. You know, today we don't pray on dates. In fact, they don't even call them dates anymore. Why not pray if you're both Christians? And then when you start talking seriously, how about asking God to lead and to direct? So many marriages today are on the basis of physical attraction rather than that inner beauty of character. Because I want to tell you, that physical attraction soon passes unless there's something to back it up with called Christian character. Yes, it has to start in courtship. Did you know it's a very interesting thing that I was reading the other day, something that was almost unbelievable? It said in this, a survey was taken in the Middle West, and they could only find one divorce in 400 homes where the family went to church regularly and where they read the Bible every day and where they had prayer in the home every day. One divorce in 400. The national average is 1 in 4. This indicates to me that if you go to church and read your Bible and pray and believe in Christ and are a disciple of Christ, it's a guarantee, almost totally a guarantee, of a completely successful marriage. It seems to me that our sociologist and psychiatrist and all of our family counselors would understand that one thing. That if you take a survey of America, you'll find that among those that go to church and pray and read their Bibles and live for Christ, divorce very rarely takes place. Now, sometimes it does. And sometimes it may be necessary. The scripture says, in the fear of the Lord is strong confidence, and his children shall have a place of refuge. A girl writing to a columnist signed her letter the other day wondering, and here's what she said. I know this sounds rather naive, but can you tell me how a girl decides on who she's going to marry? Do you know what the servant of Abraham said when he was going out to look for a wife for Isaac? He said, I being in the way, the Lord led me. You give your life to Christ. Receive him as your Lord and Savior. Put your life in his hands. Let him fill your heart. You will be in the way. God will lead you to the right girl or to the right fellow. And it'll be God's choice, because you see, God has someone picked out just for you. And if you try to find that girl or that fella on your own, you're going to make a tragic mistake. You'll get less than God's best. Let him help you in picking out the right person. Secondly, a successful marriage is one that is a daily fidelity to the marriage vow. You promise to be faithful till death do you part. The scripture has put a fence around marriage. And God has said, thou shalt not. What is it? Thou shalt not commit adultery. The sex sin before marriage will break down your character and your ideals, and it will certainly jeopardize your future marriage. Put that down. Sex outside of marriage is a sin according to the Bible. Not because God doesn't want you to have a good time. It's a sin because of what it does to you psychologically, what it does to your future marriage. And many of our sociologists and psychiatrists are now coming to say that that is true, the sense of guilt that it leaves, and especially among young women. But there are many other things that I won't go into tonight. But the Bible says, thou shalt not commit adultery. And after your marriage, and you commit this sin, the Bible says it's one of the seven deadly sins and one of the worst sins that you can commit before God. And the Bible says it hardens your heart toward God more than any other sin. If you're living that kind of a life, you can almost put it down. You're not going to come to Christ. Because you harden your heart. It's possible to come to Christ. It's possible to come and ask his forgiveness and he will forgive you. But your heart hardens. And it's hard for you to have a relationship to God. But if you tonight are willing to turn from that sin and give it up, willing to break off that relationship that God condemns, Christ died on the cross for your sins, and you can find forgiveness, and you can put your wrecked life back together again. With God's help, he will forgive you, and you can leave here as clean and as pure as though you had never committed a sin. But this sin was so terrible in God's sight that in the Old Testament, he demanded the death penalty. You know, it's very interesting to me that in the Old Testament, when God laid out the laws of how society was to be regulated, there was capital punishment. And it's very interesting that capital punishment went to the man and the woman who was caught in the act of adultery. And God was wanting to show to the world how serious the marriage vow is. Because you see, you take this vow before God. And the Bible talks about eyes full of adultery. He that looketh upon a woman, Jesus said, and has lust in his heart, is already guilty. And Job said, I've made a covenant with my eyes. Why should I look upon a maid? Thirdly, a successful marriage not only has fidelity to the marriage vow, but it's also a daily family altar. That means having daily prayer. In Acts 5, it says, and daily in every house they cease not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. The scripture continually talks about the church in the house. You are to have prayer and Bible reading in your home. Do you have it in your home? Do you say a blessing at the table before you eat? Do you have a time when you get your family together for a few minutes and you read them a few verses and have a prayer? In our home, we have prayer and Bible reading. We make it very brief and very short. I've never had one of my children rebel, so far at least, against devotions in the home, because we've tried to make it interesting, we've tried to make it brief. And if we ever have a minister in and he prays too long, my little boy will remind him right in front of all of us, to our embarrassment, that it was a little long for the prayer. Maybe you've never had Bible reading and prayer in your home, and you'd be a little embarrassed to talk to your wife about it or your husband about it, and you don't know how to bring it up. It's sort of an embarrassing subject, and you know, I've never understood that. Why it's embarrassing to talk about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Is it embarrassing to talk about the Queen of England? Is it embarrassing to talk about some famous film star? Is it embarrassing to talk about some scientific discovery? Why is it embarrassing to talk about the creator of the whole universe? And why are we timid about talking to him? We have the privilege of coming into his presence every day, into the throne room, and it will do more to help solve your problems as a family. And yet we don't use that privilege. Why? Has Satan somehow trapped us into thinking that prayer doesn't count? You know, a lot of people wait until their children are grown or half grown before they start trying to teach them anything, and then it's too late. Unless you have your child pretty well by the time he's 5 or 6, it's almost too late. The Bible says, here a little, there a little, precept upon precept, a little bit here, a little bit there. You can't wait till he gets to be about 12 or 13 and suddenly try to jam religion down his throat. It won't work. You've got to start when they're small and do it a little bit at a time. But you say, Billy, I've already been such a failure as a parent. Start now. A little bit now. Ask God to forgive you in the past. Say, oh God, I've been a failure. Please help me and forgive me. He will. And if you are sincere in your heart about it and you really make a turn and a change tonight, I believe that God will help you with those children no matter what age they are. You can start tonight. And then fourthly, for a successful marriage, there must be a dedicated father and a husband. The scripture says, and the Lord said, for I know Abraham, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord. Wouldn't it be wonderful if God could say that about me? For I know, Billy Graham, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord. Wouldn't you like that to be said about you? The Bible says Moses was faithful in all his house. Now, sometimes that takes help from the wife. One man looked very depressed as he came out of his office after the first day with his new secretary. And he was asked why, and he replied that he had entrusted the hiring of a new secretary to his wife. Very interesting, replied his friend. Is she a blonde or a brunette? She's bald, snapped the man. But it takes a dedicated husband and father for a successful home. And the Bible holds the man accountable and responsible. In our home, my wife has had to be father and mother. And she's done a magnificent job. And I give her credit tonight. She's reared them with a Bible in one hand and a hickory stick in the other. And so far, it's worked. The Bible talks about people in the church, and it says, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection. You know, we're developing in this country sort of a matriarchal society in certain segments of our society, where the husband is failed. This is not the failure of the wife. The wife has to take over. As almost in the case of my home, because I've traveled so much. I'm thankful for a Christian wife who, in all humility, has tried to fill the place of husband and father and wife and mother. But it's a dangerous trend in a society when it becomes a matriarchal society, because God has ordained that the man shall be the head of the house, and a man is to be the breadwinner in the family. This is a man's responsibility, and if the man is not meeting that responsibility, God is going to hold him responsible at the judgment. You say, well, I haven't been the right kind of a husband, and I haven't been the right kind of a father. What am I going to do? Get on your knees right now and ask God to forgive you, and determine from this moment on that you're going to live a new life. You're going to let Christ into your heart. You're going to ask Him to forgive your sin and come into your life and make you the right kind of a husband and the right kind of a father. And then, fifthly, to have a successful marriage, there must be a devoted wife and mother. The Bible says, let mothers first show piety at home, for that is good and acceptable before God. The Bible says women should guide the house and give none occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully. And you know, sometimes on a television interview, we'll see a housewife that's being interviewed and they say, what do you do? And she says, well, I'm just a housewife. Sort of apologizing. I'm no star. I'm no glamour person. I'm just an ordinary housewife. Well, I want to say that to be a housewife and to be a mother is the greatest calling in the world. Now, you men ought to applaud that, because that is right. And then sixthly, there must be disciplined children. The Apostle Paul said that one of the signs of the latter days will be disobedient to parents. And we see today disobedient children. Absalom was brought to the judgment of God in his later life because he disobeyed his father. And in the Bible, in the Old Testament, children were severely punished for rebelling against their parents. Now, there's a strange teaching going on today that children naturally rebel against their parents, that all children reach an age when they rebel against their parents. Don't you believe it? I never really felt rebellion against my parents in the sense we're talking about today. My wife says she never felt any rebellion against her parents. Nothing but love and reverential fear of her parents, according to the Bible. And I've talked to hundreds of people asking them, did you rebel against your parents? They said, no. I didn't have time. I was working too hard. And then sixthly, a determined destiny. Get your house in order, the scripture says. Is your own house in order? Have you made a decision for Christ? The scripture says, choose you this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. Tonight, you can receive Christ. Fathers, husbands, wives, mothers, young people, children, you can receive Christ and go back to your home tonight, forgiven of your mistakes and failures and sins of the past, walking with a renewed life, because Christ has died for you and risen again from the dead and offers all of you tonight forgiveness, reconciliation to God, and reconciliation to each other. Bill and Joanne Yinger a moment ago told us how Christ had come into their home and it changed their home and changed their lives. Christ can do the same for you if you let Him. You say, but what do I have to do? First, you must repent of your sin. That means you're willing to say, oh God, I've sinned. I'm willing to give up my sins. I'm willing to change my way of life. That's repentance. And secondly, by faith you receive Him as your Savior. You cannot understand it intellectually all the way, but by faith you receive Him. And you're willing to go back and live a clean, wholesome life before God. Now, this doesn't mean you'll be perfect. You'll still have pressures and problems of every kind, perhaps more than before. But God will be in your heart. He will be there to help you every day and every hour to do one of the greatest tasks He ever assigned us, to have our part in a home somewhere. As a son, as a daughter, as a father, as a mother, as a husband and a wife, I'm going to ask you to receive Him. Husband and wife can come together tonight. Whole families can come together. Servicemen, come and receive Christ as your Lord and your Savior. And leave this stadium tonight knowing that the past is forgiven and that you're going to start leading a new life and a different life from tonight on. I'm going to ask you to do something hard. I'm going to ask you to get up out of your seat right now. Hundreds of you. Get up out of your seat and come and stand in front of this platform and say tonight, I receive Christ. You may be a member of the church. You may not be a member of any church. You may be Catholic or Protestant or whatever you may be. But you need Christ in your heart. I'm going to ask you to come. And after you've all come and stood here, we're going to have a prayer and I'm going to say a word to you. We're going to give you some literature. Then you can go back and join your friends. If you're with friends or relatives, they'll wait on you. You get up and come. Why do I ask you to come forward? Because every person Jesus called in the New Testament, He called publicly. Just as when you got married, you said, I will publicly. So you come to Christ tonight and say, I will publicly. That settles it and seals it in your life. You get up and come. We're going to wait on you right now. Quickly, from all over the stadium, hundreds of you. You may be a member of the choir. You may be a serviceman visiting. Wherever you're from, you come.
You can make that same commitment right where you are. Just pick up the phone and call the number you see on your screen. Special friends are waiting to talk with you and pray with you about this most important decision.
Hundreds of people here in the Alamo Stadium in San Antonio, Texas, are filing down in front of this platform from all over this stadium to make their commitment to Jesus Christ and ask Him to forgive their sin and change their life. You can make that same commitment that have been watching by television. In your home, in a bar, in a hotel lobby, wherever you may be, you can say yes to Christ and ask Him to come into your heart and cleanse you and make you a new person. I hope that you'll do it. God bless you.
If you just prayed that prayer with my Father, or if you have any questions about a relationship with Jesus Christ, I would just call that number that is on the screen. There'll be someone there to talk with you, pray with you, and answer those questions. And remember, God loves you.
If you would like to commit your life to Jesus Christ, please call us right now toll-free at 1-800-380-6804. That's 1-800-380-6804. Or you can write to us at Billy Graham, 1 Billy Graham Parkway, Department C, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28201. Or you can contact us on the web 24/7 at billygrahamtv.org. We'll get the same helps to you that we give to everyone who responds at the invitation. On behalf of Franklin Graham and the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, thank you for watching and thank you for your prayers.